was Mike after receiving an isolated head strike with a 300-kilo cement sheet.
Can I clarify his injury? Slab hit him from where? The front or the back?
It appears right on top of his skull here. He went from a GCS of 3.
And the risk is that he has severe bleeding on the brain.
2 mils are quite sluggish.
Yeah. Without oxygen to your brain, become brain dead. And so it becomes a
life-threatening injury. Yeah, he's not liking that.
Michael, you're in hospital. It's okay.
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I start to wonder, wonder if I'm slipping under, under. Oh, would you rescue me? Would you give my
very worried for you, my friend.
The bone's being smashed to bits.
Whoa!
He's actually stopped breathing.
Leah.
Without intervention, he's quite likely to die.
Better?
I've just done a trauma call. I've told Resus in charge, and I think, oh, that's probably them calling back. Royal Melbourne, Michelle speaking.
Emergency doctor Michelle Thornhill has been working in the ED for 6 years.
Okay, let me know if you need any help with any trauma.
Staying fit helps Dr. Michelle juggle the demands of work and family.
How are you feeling this morning?
Pretty good.
Yeah.
Had a good night's sleep.
Oh, good.
And it's a great morning, so it'll be good to loosen up, working later.
Along with her colleague, emergency doctor Scott Taylor, Michelle loves a park run.
3, 2, 1, run!
Away we go. To say it's probably equally rewarding at the end. One, you're saving lives. The other one, I'm probably saving my life.
And today, in a non-stop ED, she's still running.
Royal Melbourne, Michelle speaking. Yes. Today I'm the EPIC, which means I'm the emergency physician in charge. It's extremely busy. We have many sick patients coming in. It's my job to find doctors who can treat them quickly. So we have a helicopter arriving with a seriously injured motorbike rider.
Air ambulances touching down with the badly injured man from country Victoria. The 61-year-old motorbike rider is being rushed in after colliding with a vehicle.
What's his name?
Oh, Bear. Where did
the hell is he called? Hi, Bear. I'm Sarah.
Hello.
Hi.
Emergency nurse Sarah Thomas has assisted on hundreds of motorbike accidents. And seen and heard it all.
I did not say that.
You did, and it's okay.
No, I didn't.
All right, everyone ready? Ready, set, go.
I'm just going to pop a bunch of monitoring on you, OK?
Yeah, no worries.
Yeah.
Everyone happy for a handover?
61-year-old gentleman riding a motorbike downhill. He was sideswiped right side by an oncoming vehicle, which has knocked him off his bike, and he's slid about 20 or 30 metres. Impact looks right side. He's got tip fib, which is open with evident deformity.
How's that leg?
Really bad.
Really bad.
Oh, yeah. Around the 9, 10, and I'm shooting up towards 14. Oh, buzz like hell.
Tow truck driver Bear's leg was smashed when the full weight of his bike fell on him.
Were you able to get up and walk from the scene at all?
No. I had to crawl off the road.
He's in a lot of pain. He's got significant injuries from the accident that he's been in. So just trying to figure out exactly what those injuries are.
Okay, looking at elbow.
Bear has a serious open fracture, which means his broken bone has pierced through his skin.
X-ray.
More hands are needed. Emergency doctor George Plunkett gets up to speed.
He's 61 years old, motorbike rider.
His number's good?
His number's all good. He doesn't 10 out of 10 pain output on his leg.
Well, the obvious injury Bear's got is a broken shin bone and the little bone next to it. And those bones have unfortunately come out and poked through the skin.
Patrick, George, how are you going? I've got somebody with an open tib fib down here. So this is a motorcycle versus car.
open fractures are really prone to getting infections in them.
Here you go.
I'm George, one of the emergency doctors. How are you getting on?
Like shit.
Yeah, I know. Made a bit of a mess of that leg. Yeah?
Yeah.
So it's broken, that needs surgery.
Wounds like this that are left without appropriate management are really high risk of getting really nasty infections into the bone and lead the bone to not really heal at all. So then you've got a leg that doesn't really function.
Then we need to wash that wound out and put you in a plaster.
This is possibly a life-altering injury for Bear. You might not be able to do those activities that somebody might think are normal and key to their life.
Maybe about half an hour.
But
just been called by the ambulance to say they're bringing someone who's been critically injured. It's turning into a manic Monday. So, gentlemen.
Gentlemen? Gentlemen usually means I need your help ASAP. I'm
sharing the load. So they've just called through another trauma. It's a man who had a concrete slab, they think about 300 kilos at a worksite, fall onto his upper body.
Emergency doctor Glenn Harrison takes the case.
Let's get ready.
Just received a call, 29-year-old male who's got a severe head injury. He may well have skull and facial fractures, amongst spinal fractures as well. And that the risk is that he has severe bleeding on the brain.
Paramedics arrive with critically injured stonemason, Michael. In excruciating pain and losing consciousness, they sedated him and put in a breathing tube so he would survive the trip to emergency.
He is on a ventilator. Raises suspicions for us that he does actually have a severe brain injury, and so it becomes a
potentially life-threatening injury. Tim, we're going to have to flatten him down to get him across.
I'm just worried that he might have severe complications, including seizures and increased swelling on the brain.
Can you just have a look at his pupils? Just tell me what they're doing.
Equals two.
The pupils are symmetrical and equal at the moment. The warning would be if there's abnormal pupils size on one side, that is a big warning sign for us. And he would need to have urgent neurosurgery.
Right, we're ready on three, one, two.
Good. Guys, happy to start your primary? Do the handover here? Yeah, that's great.
All right, everyone, this is Michael, found by his colleagues out in regional Victoria today at 10 a.m., receiving an isolated head strike with a 300-kilo cement sheet. He's got obvious head injury. The ALS guys have arrived on scene to find him agitated, combative, and unable to facilitate assessment. The injuries that we've been able to ascertain is a mix between penetrating and blunt force to the superior region of his skull.
Can I clarify his injury?
Yep.
The slab hit him from where? The front or the back?
It appears right on top of his skull here.
Right.
He's also got a slight gash to his right eye as well. Okay. I've got photos of the mechanism on Sheila.
All right, good.
Michael was crushed when the cement slab he was installing fell onto him.
Looking at the photos, that's a significant weight that's fallen on his head, and that raises real high risks for this patient.
OK, primary survey, please.
Okay, so intubated, trachea's midline. He's got equal air entry to bilateral lungs. Tummy soft and untender. 2 mils and quite sluggish.
Yep.
His head injury could be life-changing, but he may also have critical internal injuries, putting his life in immediate danger.
What images have you done so far, sorry?
I've done both sides of the abdomen as occluded superficie.
OK, so no free fluid, no pneumothorax, just in the cardiac to finish off. OK, we'll get our x-rays. Chest and pelvis, please, yeah, thank you. Has everyone got lead on?
Yeah.
That's OK, it's pelvis more than anything else, thank you.
That's the best you're going to get, but you can clear it.
X-rays of the pelvis are unclear. CT will show the extent of Michael's injuries.
We need some suction in there.
We're not sure where the blood is coming from. It could be that he's bleeding internally, so we need to get him to CT as soon as possible to find out where this bleeding's coming from.
I just suctioned a whole heap of blood out of the mouth. Need some suction in there.
In trauma one, stonemason Michael has suffered a catastrophic head injury when a 300-kilogram slab of concrete fell onto him.
I just suctioned a whole heap of blood out of the mouth.
Nurse Liz has identified he's bleeding from his mouth, uncontrolled bleeding is dangerous in a trauma patient, and so we need to stabilise him and get him to CT as soon as possible.
Oh, hi, it's Michelle from Royal Melbourne.
Michael may not make it. Dr. Michelle calls his wife, who's on her way.
All right.
Let's package for CT.
I told CT they're ready.
Dr. Glenn gets everyone moving. They can't wait a moment longer. Michael's life is in danger.
3, 1, 2,
the risks of taking Michael around to CT out of the emergency department for a patient that's unstable, that runs the risk of a patient becoming even more unstable.
Right, now's the waiting game.
Worst case scenario now for Michael is that he's got significant swelling and pressure within his brain that requires going to theatre urgently.
He's got traumatic frontal blood with probably a contusion. He's got some facial fractures, same side.
So looking at Michael's scans, he's got significant injuries to the bones of his face and the frontal bones of his forehead. He's also got bleeding on the brain and bruising of the brain. And so they're significant injuries. I'm worried those injuries will get worse with more bleeding and more pressure in the next couple of hours. We need to make sure we're looking after his pulse and his blood pressure. All those things will help prevent secondary brain injury.
Okay, we're getting you some pain relief now.
Dr. George is looking after 61-year-old tow truck driver Bear, who may lose the use of his leg after it was badly smashed when he came off his motorbike.
I've had a chat to my orthopaedics team.
Yep.
They're on their way down to help us out with this. We also need to do some CTs. You know, you've got a pretty distracting injury there, so we want to make sure that you're not so distracted by the bone sticking out that you're missing other bits and pieces.
I'm giving you pain relief through your drip now, OK?
All right.
Rightio, I'll get things organised and we'll get this fixed up for you.
No worries, thanks very much.
Because we can't necessarily tell what injuries he's got that aren't so obvious, he needs CT scans of his brain, of his neck, and all the way down through all of his abdominal organs and his pelvis.
You're allowed to make a phone call on my behalf?
Yeah. Who do you want me to call?
My sister.
Your sister?
Yeah.
Bear lives hundreds of kilometres from the Royal Melbourne and has no one who can be with him.
What's happened?
Why don't you talk to dear sweet?
Sarah.
Hi,
my name's Sarah. I'm a nurse at the Royal Melbourne Hospital. How are you?
I'm devastated. He's such an important part of my life. The bike, that lifestyle, riding a motorcycle was something that he loved to do and it made him enjoy his life.
When the accident happened, Bear was on his brand new bike, getting ready for a very special ride.
I bought that bike to... It was my youngest son who died 7 years ago.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that. That's horrible.
I'm supposed to be... I've organised a memorial run for him.
Yeah.
That bike was supposed to carry me and a small memory urn.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're supposed to be going over to Western Australia to Wave Rock.
Oh, God.
Yeah. And then this...
OK. This is just to prepare you for the sedation that we're going to give you to pop your leg back in a normal spot. Have you got the drugs drawn up, George?
I do.
You do?
I've gone through one of the orthopaedic doctors here. What we're going to do is get that cleaned up with a plaster on, get you over to the scanner.
Bear's shattered lower leg will be pulled back into place before plastering.
So in a tick, I'm going to give you some medication, drip you up to sleep, yeah?
Yep.
I'll give it to you kind of one beer at a time rather than making you shotgun the six-pack. That way we get you asleep well, but for the shortest period of time and with the fewest complications. So don't be surprised that you're not going to be straight out like a light, OK? Right.
What we're wanting to do with sedation is provide enough anaesthetic that he's pain-free, that he can't recall what happened, and that he has a pleasant experience.
Going in now, you'll probably start feeling a little bit sleepy soon, okay? Try and keep your eyes open for us. Just essentially like a couple of beers.
I don't drink.
Oh, well, you smoke and you ride bikes, but you don't drink.
Yes, and I've also been to war and all the rest, but
you've
I
been
do
to
not
war,
drink.
Okay. Which war did you go to?
Somalia, Afghanistan, Iraq.
What unit?
Hello.
Yeah, he doesn't drink, so he's got,
oh,
like...
Okay. I'm going to give him a little...
No tolerance.
Only go... Yeah, so 40-40. 40
and 40.
Yep. It's good to go, Patrick.
Nice deep breath.
As they begin the procedure, there's something wrong. Bear is not breathing.
People aren't breathing. They're not getting air in. They're not getting oxygen in. Their oxygen levels can fall. Then we have to take further steps, more aggressive steps, to make sure we take over his breathing for him. We make sure that, first off, we don't panic, that things aren't catastrophically getting out of control. And if we think the airway is obstructed, is to pop a piece of plastic tubing in the mouth that goes into the back of the throat and holds the tongue forward, try and keep airways open.
...61-year-old motorbike rider Bear has stopped breathing.
Non-rebreather's off, bag valve is on. Do you want it back on?
That's right, we'll see how we're going.
Bear stopped breathing, so we need to address that pretty quickly.
Decided to put his stents back up. You said you've got this on?
Yep, it's on.
Cool.
They keep pumping air into him as Dr. Patrick works quickly to get the plaster on.
There you go. Now.
He's breathing.
Yep. So I'm getting a couple more breaths in and I'll swap back over. OK, I'll swap back over. He's good now.
Do you have a motorbike?
Do I have a motorbike?
Yeah.
Do you think I've got a motorbike?
No. Right. You never know, though. I never thought you'd played in an orchestra either, but you do. You're okay, mate.
Oh, thanks for helping. Greatly appreciated.
That's all right.
Time to wake up, my friend. All done. Oh, hello.
It's
you
all
might
done.
Be one of the best patients I've had. You do everything I say. All finished.
See you, mate.
You're awesome.
I'll take that. If he had not had the support that he received, he may very well have not started breathing for too long, which can be really dangerous.
Suddenly, he's in trouble again.
Bear, Bear, Bear.
All right, we're back.
29-year-old stonemason Michael has just been scanned for potentially life-changing injuries after being crushed by a 300-kilogram block of concrete.
Just wonder whether he just moved.
To keep Michael safe while they wait for the CT results, it's vital he stays fully sedated.
Yes, he's moving. I might just bump this infusion up.
But he's waking up.
Yeah, he's not liking that. Yeah, it's going to bolus him.
Michael, you're in hospital. It's OK.
It's important we keep Michael stable and sedated on the ventilator.
I've just bolused him 50 of probes and I put him at 120 an hour.
We're on the risk of him pulling out his intubation lines and his IV lines, and so that's a real risk for him.
Yeah, much better.
All right, we're winning.
Cool, well done. Good troubleshooting team.
With Michael now stable, his wife Tegan can be with him.
It's no doubt the worst day of my life.
We've been together 13 years. He's my best friend.
For Tegan, it's an agonising wait to see if her husband will ever be the same.
We have a 3-year-old daughter, Minnie. And he's a really good dad. She's everything to him.
Dr. Glenn can now see the full extent of Michael's shocking injuries.
There's certainly extensive fractures through his face that'll probably need to have something done from the plastic surgeon. We can see here that there's bleeding in the frontal lobes here on the right-hand side of the brain, and we can see that there's probably a little bit more blood underlying that area between the skull and the actual brain tissue. The big thing that we do see here, that bruising on the brain.
There's lots of different ways this may manifest. So Michael may have some difficulties communicating and there may be seizures. So what's next for Michael is really a period of time in the intensive care unit. Michael's brain injury is potentially serious, and time will tell with further testing. But Michael's not out of the woods just yet.
Three babies to get a cake on
you. I know, I was just saying that. I've had three, I even had two at once, and nobody bought me a cake. I feel like this is a good moment.
When we came back, we didn't get a cake.
Yeah, no, I didn't get a cake. Maybe, maybe we can make this everyone's cake.
Everyone's cake.
Senior emergency doctors Emma West and Maya Kubert are celebrating Dr. Jana Alexander's return from maternity leave.
This is delicious.
Beautiful
time.
Cheers to you.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. And so now we can end the debate about what's easier, being at work or being at home with three kids.
Being at home with three kids is much harder.
Yeah, there's no debate about that.
Yep, all right, cool. Thanks for your help, Andrew. Bye.
It's not long before Dr. Meyer's back on the ED floor. Her next patient, 74-year-old Jerry, has arrived with severe chest pains.
In our usual workup of chest pain, we get a chest x-ray. And Jerry's chest x-ray is very concerning. There's a shadow around what we call the aorta, or big vessel in his chest.
So what kind of pain was it? Did it wake you up from sleep?
Oh, yeah, it woke me up.
So have you ever been told you've got any issues with your heart?
No.
Now, I would normally use a CT scan with iodine-based contrast. I can't do that for Jerry because he has anaphylaxis to contrast dye.
Have you ever had rheumatic fever as a child?
No.
No.
Been disgracefully healthy, most of all.
One of the ways we can look at the aorta is using an ultrasound machine. Jana is much better at ultrasound and echocardiography than I am, so I've asked her to have a look.
Dr. Myers asked me to look for a small tear in your big artery coming out of your heart. We are trained to look for the scary, life-threatening things. I'm just going to get you to pop your head back for me, and I'm just going to have a little look up here.
Jerry's son, Chris, rushed to his side as soon as he heard his father was in trouble.
Thanks for coming in, Chris.
I was a bit shocked that there could be something this wrong with his heart. We both ran marathons, so he's been a great role model for my dad, so it's difficult to see him unwell.
Has anyone ever told you you've had a narrowing of one of your valves?
No.
No.
Is that what's happened?
Well, look, you know, we can't exclude it on this ultrasound. We need to have a chat to the specialist and figure out how we're going to investigate you further, OK?
OK, that would be an appointment at a later date.
No. You're not going anywhere until we figure it out.
Right, OK.
OK, so not an outpatient thing. This is a today thing. I'll have a chat with Maya. She's your doctor officially, so I'll just go let her know what I saw, and then all the best. And she'll give me help. No probs.
Dr. Jana's ultrasound has revealed a potentially fatal problem.
So he's got aortic stenosis.
Yeah.
And it looks like calcification around the valve.
So when Jana had a look, Jerry has a big bulging area where the wall of his aorta has become thin and has popped out. That's a big vessel. It delivers the blood to the rest of the body. If it were to rupture, he would be at significant risk of death.
Just take a breath, mate. Nice deep breath for me. You okay?
In emergency, Nurse Sarah is looking after 61-year-old Bear, who stopped breathing twice.
Do you have sleep apnea? Do you stop breathing in your sleep?
No.
No? You did a little bit there, just a little bit.
I did.
So I might actually just pop some oxygen on you, because your sats are dropping.
Some people stop breathing when they're snoring. Some people stop breathing with the anaesthetic.
Don't lift your head up.
Wow.
We need to make sure we keep him safe, but that's why we keep so much monitoring on these patients.
We're going to go to CT.
A trauma patient like this will be managed as though they've had a spinal injury until we've proven they don't.
All right, Bear. We're just going to roll you and move you onto the CT table, OK?
Somebody in Bear's case will be imaged entirely through their spine to look for any fractures.
Don't stop breathing. Just remember to take some deep breaths, all right? One, two, three. So we're hoping for Bear that we don't see any internal bleeding or internal injuries. I'm hoping that it's just localised to his leg, but there's nothing else going on.
Will I get a coffee today?
No. I think Bear's probably feeling alone, which is really sad. Maybe a little bit disappointed that he wasn't able to do what he set out to do on his ride. Considering the meaning of it, it's quite significant.
Back in my little room.
Back in your little big room. I will go and find something to put on your lips if I can, okay?
Oh, no, I shouldn't, but...
You just give me a minute, Bear. I'll be right back. It's all about the small things. He has very dry lips. It's incredibly important for people to feel heard. As human beings, all we want is for somebody to hear us and to understand and to empathise. It's a really important aspect of our job. All right, this stuff is peppermint lip balm. Better than nothing, yeah?
And I can't have water or anything.
Open, open, like, yep.
No, what? I've never worn a lippy.
I can't live without mine. My lip balm, not the lipstick, obviously. All right, is that better? A little bit?
Yeah.
Yeah. You're allowed this much. Don't tell anybody. Swirl it around.
Open a bit more. Angel.
I'll settle for Angel.
Bear's results are finally in.
This is his leg. Yeah, so it's all just totally shattered. It should be one single straight bone. Instead, broken. You know, an injury like this is going to mean multiple operations, time in rehabilitation, prolonged recovery time, and the question remains to be seen how fully Bear will recover from this. Will he get totally back to where he is, or will he still be left with some deficits?
Bear may never be able to do the memorial ride for his son.
So for Bear next, he gets admitted under the trauma unit, and then his care will transfer over to the orthopaedics team because he needs surgery for this leg within the next 24 hours. Just going to be in the lap of the gods as to how well he recovers.
...74-year-old Jerry needs urgent CT scans after arriving in emergency with severe chest pain.
Oh, hi there, it's Maya here in ED. Could you put me through to a cardiothoracic ridge on call, please?
Jerry's X-ray and ultrasound have revealed a life-threatening problem. Dr. Maya alerts the cardiothoracic team.
See whether you might have capacity to look at the CT and the chest X-ray and help me decide whether that's required.
So for me, my job is to make a diagnosis. And my other job, while doing that, is to get all the people around Jerry that he will need to keep him safe while we get on and fix the problem.
I don't like the look of the scan. Hi, it's Maya again. I just wondered if you'd had a chance to pull up scans. They're very abnormal. He's got a very large aortic aneurysm on the root of his aorta. The radiology consultant is having a look at it at the moment, but they are concerned, I'm concerned.
Aortic pathologies are life-threatening diseases. They're like walking around with a time bomb in your chest. They can rupture at any moment and they will cause you to die. He's going to need urgent surgery.
All right, I'm gonna go and tell him. You just shuffle a bit. There you go. Can you see that?
Yep.
That white bit there is normal. That's your heart. But that, see that bit there?
Yep.
That's not normal. So then on the scan, if we look in here, this is us going from the head down towards your feet. And that's the sac. So this is the pipe. That's an arch?
Yes.
And that's the sac that shouldn't really be there?
Yes.
That's not okay. That sac is not a new problem. That didn't come today.
Right.
But that bit further down with the calcium, and that could be the cause of your pain. It could be that something's displaced a bit.
But the pain is
still there? Yeah, still there, yes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But it's sort of a dull ache now.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Potentially like a quick burst.
Yeah, that's the worry. There's a problem, it needs fixing, and yeah, we need to do that today.
Right.
And it's right to be a little bit frightened, I think. That's okay.
Yeah, that's... Not used to being...
No, you go from no doctors to too many.
I had no thought that my dad would have an issue like this. I thought of all the things he could have, I was just in disbelief.
what next. So they're looking at your scans now, and that's what will happen next. In the meantime, I'm going to move you to just a slightly more visible part of the department.
Thank you.
If you were to eyeball him from the end of the street, you'd say he looks fine. There's nothing wrong with that guy. But his underlying diagnosis is of a life-threatening condition.
How are you, Kerry?
During a busy shift in emergency, Dr. Emma takes a break for a specially prepared treat.
Mm-hmm. It's actually pretty good.
The chef is Dr. Emma's 14-year-old daughter.
This is the first time Maggie's actually made me dinner, and it's really good, so I'll be ordering from her all the time.
Dr. Emma's meal is cut short. A young woman just weeks away from having a baby has arrived in acute pain.
And where's your pain? And when did it start?
5 days ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
20-year-old Ellie and her partner Fraser were told to come into the emergency department by their GP.
So you're 32 weeks pregnant,
yeah.
First baby.
Yeah.
But this must make you feel a little bit nervous.
Yeah, it's just, I don't want to deal with the pain.
Yes, yeah. Okay.
Struggles to sleep.
Yeah.
Okay. Ellie actually appears relatively relaxed. She just wants to know what the cause of her pain is. She appears fresh, she just, you know, really wants to get to the bottom of the problem. But she's presented with chest pain, and chest pain in pregnancy is a really worrying problem. Have you had any fevers? Faint or dizzy?
Sometimes dizzy.
Okay, but... and is that normal or?
I think that's normal.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
And then have you had any calf pain?
Yeah, on the right.
Okay.
Yeah.
And when did you notice that?
Like a week ago.
Pregnancy puts you at risk of a number of quite serious medical conditions. One of them, probably the worst one, is something called a pulmonary embolism, a clot travelling from your leg up into your lungs and causing chest pain. At worst, is a life-threatening condition. And combining that with pregnancy, it puts both the baby at risk and also the mother. I want to just have a little feel of your tummy. So that's sore.
Yeah.
Yes, sorry about that.
It's okay.
You're feeling baby moved today?
A little, yeah.
Yeah. Do you have any family history of clots on the lung?
No.
That's all?
Yeah.
Yeah, and that side's not sore. Okay, no worries. Not sure if it's actually something in your tummy, like a gallstone?
Yeah.
Or it even could be something in your chest?
Yeah.
There's a condition where you can get a clot from your leg that goes to your lung.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's one of the concerns. I'll come back shortly.
With both lives in danger, Dr. Emma wastes no time getting Ellie x-rayed. The source of her pain must be found immediately. Dr. Emma also needs her to have an urgent ultrasound.
I do need a diagnosis tonight.
With radiology busier than normal, Dr. Emma calls on emergency doctor Luke Delarue, an ultrasound specialist.
But can you tell me that she's got no big gallstones? I know it's
yeah,
not.
Yeah, I can see
I know it's not definitely.
Yeah, I can see if there's but obvious if, gallstones.
But if they're obvious, that's sort of.
Yeah.
Working in emergency, you work with people who have different interests, special skills, and it's really drawing on each other's strengths and making sure that you do the best for the patient. And so I'm lucky to have Luke around.
So I'm just gonna have a look at a couple of things, and the main one is your gallbladder. It can be a bit tricky. Gallbladder is this kind of round, oval-like shape. It's a bit tricky. Is that sore if I push like that?
Yeah.
All right, I'm just gonna try one more little view around the front.
She's also very tender over the right-hand side of her tummy. We're searching for other causes of her pain.
To be honest, the main difficulty is gonna be that you've got a human pushing up your diaphragm.
Yeah.
Because it'd be nice to find something that's not as life-threatening as a pulmonary embolism.
So, I can't see any stones, which is what we're looking for. It's a limited exam, though, because you've got bub in the way.
Yeah.
When was your last fetal heart rate done?
I had one today, so it was my last checkup last week.
Okay, let's just have a good look, eh?
As long as your heart's good.
Yeah, fetal heart's within normal range, definitely. It's good. I'm just doing a quick scan of her leg, so I've got to go up into the groin, is anything.
C So this is where Ellie is sore, just in this area, and it's actually nice and clear. Can't see any cause for her pain. I can't see pneumonia.
Hey, it's Luke.
Yes.
I can't get great views. All I can tell you is that at the level of, like, the inguinal canal...
There's nothing?
There's nothing, yeah.
So we really don't know what the cause of the pain is, and we don't know that there's gallstones, and it really still could be a pulmonary embolism.
With no definitive results, Ellie and her baby could be in trouble.
Part of the reason I'd like to do this scan called a CT pulmonary angiogram is it's a little bit unclear to me if it's your chest or your tummy.
Yeah.
And even if the ultrasound was normal, I would still like to go on and do a further study because I think there's possibly something wrong. If there is something wrong, I want to know about it.
He came in with some chest pain that woke him from sleep this morning at 4 a.m.
Scans revealed that 74-year-old retired schoolteacher Jerry has a potentially fatal aortic aneurysm.
Recess 5, yep.
Surgeons need to operate immediately to save his life.
Thank you, bye.
So this is extremely confronting for Jerry. He woke up this morning with a bit of pain in his chest and I've told him he might die. You can imagine it's not the way he thought his day was gonna go.
I'm horrified that I have chest surgery, you know, open heart, you know, that. But I guess it is what it is. And you do what you can to survive. I mean, if I don't have it, from what I can gather, you know, it's pretty bad. Might not have that long if I don't.
Dr. Meyer mobilises all the cardiac specialists it will take to try and save Jerry's life.
He has a life-threatening condition, and we are not often given an opportunity to fix these problems before they kill people.
Hello.
Hello, how are you?
Good, thanks for coming down. Steph's been in as well. So currently involved is the cardiothoracic team, the vascular team, both of whom have been at the bedside and also now a senior cardiac anaesthetist and a senior cardiac radiologist. The current thought is probably for an MRI to further delineate the branches of the arch of the aorta in terms of a potential plan for an elephant trunk procedure.
So this will be extremely complex surgery. He'll need a very big team of surgeons and they'll need to be very experienced vascular and cardiac surgeons to try and fix the problem without him dying on the table.
I'm going to follow up in the next few days and find out what happened to you.
Thanks, Maya.
Lovely to meet you. And I'm extremely glad that you came today.
Yes.
Yes, definitely. Thank you so much. See you.
Year-old pregnant Ellie could have a life-threatening blood clot after being rushed to ED in severe pain.
It's very clear to me that we need to find out what's wrong. I think the safest thing for you tonight is to have the CT scan because part of my worry is you've had some calf pain and chest pain. I don't know what to make of your tummy pain, but the top of your tummy will be scanned. I want to investigate Ellie for a pulmonary embolism, but it does involve a scan and radiation exposure. So I really need to be able to communicate to her the risk of the diagnosis not being made versus the risk of the radiation exposure. So there's radiation exposure to your baby, but at a very safe level. Any theoretical risk is very low. And if you put it against a risk of not finding a diagnosis that could be harmful to you or your baby, what questions does it bring up for you?
Not really any. I think
I've
explained it very well.
Okay.
Yeah. Sounds like, yeah, I mean, it's a necessary risk, I think.
Yeah.
To find out
what that's right. Yeah.
Hello.
Hello.
My name's Dan, one of the radiographers. I'm going to do a scan for your chest tonight. Okay.
If there's a clot there, there'll be a blockage and it'll be immediately apparent that she's got a pulmonary embolism. On first inspection, I can't see a clot. No evidence of acute pulmonary. So you don't have a pulmonary embolism?
Oh, good.
And there's nothing abnormal I can find in your lungs?
Good.
Just looked at your heart tracing and it's just not quite right, so I don't know what that means. So I'd like to know a little bit more about that. Regardless, I think I'm going to keep you in hospital overnight.
to get a formal ultrasound in the morning, because your tummy's a little bit sore there too, and we want to try and fix that.
Ellie's clearly got pain. It's unexplained. Any illness in pregnancy is high risk because you're really dealing with two lives. The safest thing for Ellie now is for her to be admitted to hospital. She'll have an ultrasound in the morning, she'll see a cardiologist in the morning, and I'm really hopeful that everything will be okay.
Everyone ready? Ready, set, go.
I'm just going to pop a bunch of monitoring on you, okay?
61-year-old motorbike rider Bear badly fractured his leg after colliding with a car.
Made a bit of a mess of that leg.
Yeah.
So it's broken, that needs surgery.
Bear was planning a memorial ride for his son, who passed away 7 years ago.
That bike was supposed to carry me and a small memory urn.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're supposed to be going over to Western Australia to Wave Rock.
5 days later, he's recovering after surgeons reconstructed his leg with plates and pins.
But I've come through it pretty lucky.
He has a long road ahead, but Bear's got unfinished business.
Hell or high water ain't going to stop me from getting on that bike again.
Jerry came into the emergency department with chest pain, thinking he'd be discharged and sent home the same day.
It looks like a very abnormal aortic scan.
Aortic pathologies are life-threatening diseases. They're like walking around with a time bomb in your chest, and they will cause you to die.
He needed life-saving surgery that lasted more than 8 hours. After a second mammoth surgery, Jerry is now back at home recovering.
They found another aneurysm further down in the below the heart. When they opened me up, the surgeon put his hands in to gently pull the aneurysm towards him, and it burst. The nurses and doctors at Royal Melbourne were outstanding, but it's the only word to describe them. Thank you, all of you. I felt pretty lucky having them aneurysms out. I suppose it's a... maybe I should buy a lottery ticket.
To your health.
Cheers, mate. You too. Thank you.
Ellie. Yeah. And where's your pain?
20-year-old pregnant Ellie arrived into emergency with severe abdominal and leg pain.
So that's sore?
Yeah.
That's all?
Yeah.
Dr. Emma worried Ellie's and her baby's lives were in danger.
Pregnancy puts you at risk of a number of quite serious medical conditions. One of them, probably the worst one, is something called a pulmonary embolism.
Even though the CT scan was clear, Ellie needed further investigation.
Regardless, I think I'm going to keep you in hospital overnight.
Thankfully, a beautiful, healthy little girl was born 8 weeks later, and all Ellie's tests were clear. Baby Adeline is thriving, receiving lots of loving care from her mum, Ellie. Stonemason Michael's head was crushed when a 300-kilo concrete slab fell on him.
Right now's the waiting game.
Scans revealed he had multiple fractures to his face.
We can see here that there's bleeding in the frontal lobes here.
And so they're significant injuries.
Doctors were concerned Michael would have life-altering disabilities. After only 12 days in hospital and surgery to fix his facial fractures, Michael's home with his family.
Conversation I had with the doctor, he explained the scenario. I said to him straight, how am I alive? Because I knew the weight of the stone. And the doctor said to me, you're a very lucky man. And yeah, so my main fear was what would be the future from those injuries. When I can go back to work, I'm definitely going to be working a lot less. I think an incident like this is what I needed to actually change my priorities in terms of work and life balance. And yeah, definitely want to spend more time with my wife and daughter.
She tipped the whole bubble container on what she was wearing.
For kinder. That doesn't surprise me. Does she want me to come and pick her up today?
Yeah.
Well, the treatment I received in hospital was amazing because they definitely saved my life. And yeah, that's pretty much all there is to say about it, really.